still rockin' after all these years.
This is the story of my rock and roll butler.
This is it, the show that started it all. Often imitated, but never equaled. From San Francisco, USA, online since 2004. Right. It's the one and only Rock and Roll Geek Show. With the original Rock and Roll Geek, Michael Butler.
Welcome to the Rock and Roll Geek Show. My name's Michael Butler. Thanks a lot for joining me. I really appreciate it. Today is Thursday, May 6, 2021, and it's 6:32 p.m. Pacific time when I'm doing this episode. It's a very special episode because I don't know if you can hear, but we got somebody on the line. So I'll give you a little bit of background first. Joe Pawlak, my bodyguard and friend of the show, posted on the Rock and Roll Geek Facebook group, which I did not create, but I do approve. People just got to answer two questions, so I know you're not one of those transsexuals trying to run for governor of California. He said, I will gladly donate $200 to Michael Butler if we can have a co-host gig with Richard Fusey. I will keep the mullet until he says yes, because he posted a picture of him with the mullet. So we went back and forth, and let me see if I can do the, I went on PayPal, and here's what we have so far in the tallies of the donations to get Richard Fusey on the show. Michael Cranston donated $100. Joe Pawlak, my bodyguard, donated $200. Rodney Cross, $100. So what, that's $400. Tim Shaw donated $100. Ralph Miller, friend of the show, came in with $50. Jason Wendleton, $50. Kirk Crawford, $200. So what's math is not me forte. So where are we here? $200, $250, $300, $400, $500, $600, $700, $800 we have received so far to get Richard Fusey or Fusey. We'll find out how you pronounce his name on the show. Hold on. I got to let the dogs in here. Hold on. So everybody who said they were going to donate, thank you for the donations. And on the line, I have, say your name, caller.
My name is Richard Fusey.
Fusey. See, I pronounce every pronunciation has been wrong.
Yes, you did. No. You said Fusey. Uh-huh. And you said, you have said it correctly once.
I said Fusey. I said Fusey. No, I said Fusey. Richard Fusey. Richard,
it's spelled F-U-S-E like a fuse with a Y.
Okay, so but I've been pronouncing Fusey or Fusey. I don't remember. How do you pronounce it again? Fusey or Fusey?
Fusey.
Fusey. So I've been pronouncing
that's not the original name. My grandfather, when he came from Italy.
Italy.
Yes, my father's father. Uh-huh. My father's father, they're Italian. He came from Italy, and his last name was Fucci.
Fucci, not Fusilli.
No, F-U-C-C-I.
Fucci. And he changed it to Fusey because of...
Because he wanted to be Americanized.
Okay. Because a lot of times when they came into Ellis Island...
That's where he came.
They gave them an American last name.
Yeah. He changed the last name spelling so it wouldn't look as ethnic.
Back and then...
And for then, he never talked to him and his brother wouldn't talk to each other, my uncle and my grandfather.
Ah, because they kept the name Fusilli. No, not Fusilli, Fucci.
Yeah.
And you have a New York accent. Are you from New York?
Born and raised until about 9 years ago when I was so sick and I couldn't work anymore and I had to come here because I lost my job. I couldn't pay my rent. I was evicted. I went to court. They said, you got 48 hours to get out. And I moved here to Florida.
What was your job?
I was working as a salesman at a janitorial supply cleaning company.
Uh-huh. Selling bleach and stuff.
Bleach and floor wax and mops and brooms and shit like that. And I worked in a music store for 4 years in Manhattan.
What music store?
It was called the Charles Ponte Music Company on West 46th Street in Manhattan. It was from like 71 to 74.
Was that like a sheet music place or like an instrument place?
instruments. I was an apprentice. I was learning how to repair woodwind instruments, saxophone.
Ah, so it was a band instrument music store.
And two blocks over was where all the big shots were, like Sam Ash,
right.
Alex Dick, all the big places.
That was around 42nd Street?
48th
Street, yeah.
They're all
gone. Yeah, I heard. You listen to J.J. French's podcast?
Who? J.J. French?
Yeah.
From Twisted Sister?
Yeah, he's got a podcast. It's pretty good.
I never heard it, no.
He talks a lot about the music. He tells the same story about the music stores on 48th.
If you walked into Alex Music, the walls were covered with those promo photos of every single person you could think of. Hendrix, Joplin, Clapton, Jeff Beck, I mean, all the biggies. Covered. From wall to wall.
Uh-huh, yeah. And he said that his picture was never on the wall. And I forget which one, but he got into a beef with one of the music store owners. And the guy wouldn't give him a disc. He tried to cheat him on a guitar. So he walked across the street and bought it for the same guitar for $200 cheaper. And he had a grudge against the guy since then.
Well, there was a place across the street called We Buy Guitars. That's probably where he went.
Oh, maybe. How old are you?
I'm 65.
65. I'm 50 now. I'm almost 60. So you're a little bit older than me. You're 3 years younger than Handsome.
I got to be the oldest person in the group.
In the Rock and Roll Geek Facebook group. You are definitely the most prolific person in the Rock and Roll Geek Facebook group, which, by the way.
Go ahead.
Thank you for being so prolific and keeping the group going, because you're single-handedly keeping that group active.
Well, I get a lot more out of it, I think, than they do, because it's a lot.
Everybody there, or not everybody, but some of the people there seem to think you're very sensitive. Do you know that?
I am sensitive.
You are? Because yeah. I got a Facebook message from you this morning telling me you weren't going to do the show because I came out as a woman on the Mad at Dad program.
Yeah, it was a joke.
Okay, good. I'm glad.
I listened this morning to the whole Mad at Dad, and after I read that, I wrote that for a joke.
Okay, good. I'm glad it was a joke, because I got the message at 5 o'clock this morning, because I get up at 4:45 in the morning and make my coffee, and I come down and check out the blogs and the new releases and all that before I go to work. I gotta unwind, as they say.
Oh, I didn't unwind today because I was too nervous about coming on the show.
No, you unwind on a regular basis?
Now I'm going to have to catch up on unwinding.
Yeah, I hear you. You sound like you have a Bronx accent. Are you from the Bronx?
My mother and father were. No, I was born and raised in Long Island.
Long Island, okay. I lived in Long Island for a short period of time. Not many people know this, but when I was in Stevie Sletto, the punk rock band, we had a bus, and the drummer and we were staying in Washington, D.C. at our guitar player's house, and the drummer and I decided to take a trip up to New York to try to get us some gigs, and we ended up living in that bus in the parking lot in Valley Stream, Long Island.
I know Valley Stream, Long Island, yes.
There was a shopping center there, and we lived there in that bus for about 2 months.
You paid your dues.
Yeah, and we got one gig. We got a gig at CBGB's. And did we get a gig? Yeah, we played CBGB's, but something happened, and I got a job at a paint store. I was taking sink showers at the paint store because we were like really homeless guys, and it was a very rough situation.
Yeah, it sounds like it.
It was definitely not a high point in my life.
I was never in need of anything. My father was a school principal. He made a good living.
You saw a lot of shows in New York, I'm assuming, because there's a thing on the here. You saw the Allman Brothers at New York or in Fillmore East.
When I was 16, I wanted to go to the Fillmore East to go see Hendrix when he played there on New Year's Eve and recorded. the Band of Gypsies album.
Uh-huh.
And they wouldn't let me. Why? My parents wouldn't let me go. Why? The father here at 17, I said, I'm doing what I want. I went to my first concert on May 1st, 1970. I was just turned 17, and I went to the Fillmore, and I saw Leslie West with Mountain.
Ah, that's a good one.
That's the first concert I ever saw. And after I walked out of that place, I was never the same.
How old were you then, 15?
Just had turned 17.
17. Why wouldn't your parents let you go see Hendrix? Because he was black?
I was 16. No.
You were just too young?
No, we're not prejudiced. My family. I wasn't really prejudiced. I was raised to base a person on what's inside them, how they treat me, not the color of their skin.
Yeah, that's good. Your mom used to make Sunday gravy?
My mother didn't make. My mother was a terrible cook.
Oh, really? Your dad, did dad make Sunday gravy?
No.
No?
My mother was a teacher, and my father was a principal, and that's where, and they met in the school.
So you're Italian. Nobody in the family cooked?
My mother, but she wasn't too good. Huh. My grandmother was a good cook.
So did grandma come around and feed you guys? Because all Italians in New York are supposed to eat like a big meal on Sundays.
I ate a lot of pasta.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, I weigh about 100. Well, now I weigh about 140, but back then I probably weighed about 110.
That's about what I weighed my entire youth too. About 90 to 110. I have Italian Sunday gravy in my freezer. I made a batch about 2 weeks ago.
I don't know what is that for.
Sunday gravy is a, well, they call it Sunday gravy because on Sunday the housewives or whoever would cook the meal on Sunday. You know, they have a big family dinner, and the spaghetti sauce or the sauce would cook all day long. That's why it was called Sunday gravy.
It would simmer, for a long time.
And the real Sunday gravy contains just about every meat that you can possibly put in it. I put hot sausage, mild sausage, chicken, pork, meatballs, and that's about what I put in. It's about all. And I think that's about what I put in there. All that meat, plus spaghetti, plus tomatoes and red wine and the usual stuff.
Yeah. I hope nobody's bored talking about food.
Are you bored?
No.
Good. By the way, thank you again for coming on. I really appreciate you doing this. You didn't have to come on, but we had to do a lot of talking, a lot of convincing to get you on the show.
I enjoyed that. Reading all those things, and once they started offering you the money and say he's not going to do it, I have to do it.
That's good. They browbeat you. They guilted you into coming on.
Yeah, I like listening to the show, but I have a big difference in musical taste than you.
Not according to the songs that you sent me. I asked you to send me six songs.
I like everything. I like all genres of music. I'm not stuck in one genre. I like to be, like everything from punk to metal to even some southern rock and some progressive. But I'm a guitar person. I love the guitar.
Uh-huh. You like the guitar heroes.
Yes. The Ritchie Blackmores I grew up listening to, and Beck and Page.
Uh-huh.
And Hendrix. And then later on, Zakk Wylde and Satriani and those kind of guys. But then I could listen to B.B. King, and then I could put on Crosby, Stills, and Nash right after that.
You like Steven Stills? You think he's a good guitar player?
He's underrated.
He is underrated. What about Clapton?
No comment.
He's overrated, right? That's what I think. I think he's overrated.
Clapton lost his passion to play many, many years ago. He's not relevant anymore. The only you got Jimmy Page that all he does is keep on remixing the same album over and over and over again. Clapton is getting old and boring, but Jeff Beck is still relevant.
Yeah, Jeff Beck's still the greatest guitar player, right?
One of the best. But I'm saying out of the three that were in the Yardbirds, to me, he's the only one that's still relevant.
Who do you think is the best living guitar player right now? Ted Nugent?
No, but I think Ted is a great guitarist.
Ted's underrated.
I don't care what his mouth says, he's a great rock and roll guitarist.
He sure is. So who do you think is the best living guitar player?
I don't just have one. I would say Shanker.
Think Shanker's better than Beck?
I like him as much as Jeff Beck.
But do you think he's technically a better guitar player than Jeff Beck?
Nah, Jeff Beck is an original. I like Beck. I like Shanker. I like Steve Vai. I like Joe Satriani. I liked Stevie Ray Vaughan for the blues. I like Slash. I like guys like Iommi for the riffs they make. And Hetfield from Metallica. These guys are like the riff masters.
Right. Who do you think is the best living guitar player, though? Not your favorite, but who's the best?
Who's the best? Steve Vai.
You think Steve Vai is the best living guitar player? You think he's better than Jeff Beck?
Yes, I think that Steve Vai can do anything he wants on the guitar. He's mastered it.
I won't disagree with you that Steve Vai is a great guitar player. I think Jeff Beck is probably the best living guitar player, though.
I've never seen Jeff Beck in concert.
Me neither. Me neither.
He's amazing. I have two of his concert DVDs. One from the Hollywood Bowl and one from this place in England called Ronnie Scott's.
With that cute girl on bass, right?
Tal. Her name's Tal.
Okay, yeah. Tal Wilkinson? No, not Wilkinson.
Yes.
It's Tal Wilkinson?
Yeah, that's her name.
Is she related to Leon Wilkinson from Lynyrd Skynyrd? No. I don't think so.
No.
Well, I just lost my train of thought. I had something I wanted to ask you. Fuck, I forgot.
A lot anyway. Of guys.
Oh, what I want. Have you seen that latest Frank Zappa documentary?
No.
It's on.
I have three streaming services. I have Netflix, Amazon Prime, and I have Hulu.
This is on Hulu, I'm pretty sure. It's just called Zappa. It's really good. There's actually like three Zappa documentaries that I've seen.
Is Vai in any of them?
Yes, he's in this one I just watched a couple of days ago.
Then I'll be watching it.
Yeah, he's in it. Steve Vai was on Bob Lefsetz's podcast, and he told a good story about when he auditioned for Frank Zappa.
You heard about that?
What's that?
He wanted him to transcribe something. He didn't think he'd be able to do it.
Yeah, and he asked him to play the same transcription that he did in all these different time signatures, and then he goes, oh, now play it reggae in a 7, or he would like try to fuck with his head about all these time signatures.
Yes.
And he said one time that he finally gave him something that was physically impossible to do. It was like, it couldn't be done. He goes, well, there's
the notes on a page. You couldn't even tell what they were, I heard.
Yeah, and he said, what you're right telling me to play here is physically impossible to play. And Frank Zappa goes,
you got the job, right?
No, he goes, I hear Linda Ronstadt's looking for a guitar player, and he walked out of the room. But he was fucking with him.
That seems like something he would say to somebody, because somebody told me they auditioned for him once, and he showed them a piece of paper, and the guy looked at it for 5 minutes, and then Frank said, thank you for coming.
I hear Frank Zappa can be like can come across as a jerk.
So everybody thought I would punk out, and I didn't punk out.
You didn't punk out by coming on the show, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I'm glad you didn't. So far, I'm entertained. We're only 20 minutes into this. We haven't played any music.
Yeah, I try to give you a variation of different songs.
Are you a Frank Zappa fan?
Not really. I like his, the only albums that I had of his were instrumental albums. It was called Shut Up and Play Your Guitar.
Of course, I have it.
Oh, and then Son Of, I think, or More Shut Up and Play Your Guitar.
Well, on Joe's Garage.
That's a great album, actually.
There is an instrumental on the second, you know, it's a triple album.
Black Napkins?
On Joe's Garage?
Yeah.
No, this song is called Watermelon and Easter Hay. I think it's on disc three. It's a three vinyl disc, a triple album. I believe
Joe's
it's
Garage, yeah, part one, two, and three.
Yes, yeah. And there's a song, it's a 9-minute song called Watermelon and Easter Hay. If you want to hear some of the best guitar playing you will hear in your life, listen to that song.
I will. I'm going to check it out.
I would play it now, but it's 9 minutes long.
Yeah, that takes away from the
It takes away from you, from the Joe Pollack experience, or not Joe Pollack, the Richard Fuse experience. Excuse me. Fucci. The Fucci. How about if I call you Richard Fucci?
That's fine.
Richard Fucci. All right, I'll call you that from now on.
As you call me.
Yes. So back to you leaving New York. You got sick in New York?
I got sick in New York. I didn't know what was wrong. I was living in Queens.
By yourself?
I had my own apartment, nice, big one, because I got it at the right price and at the right time. I started to call in sick at work because I wasn't feeling well. I didn't know why. I got warned by my boss quite a few times. He said, listen, when you're here, you do a great job, but you're not here enough.
How old were you then?
56.
Oh, okay.
He said, if you call in sick one more time, you're gone. A week later, I woke up. I didn't go to work. I didn't feel good. I went to the doctor. While I was at the doctor, he had left a message on my machine. When I got home from the doctor, I saw the machine blinking, telling me that there was a message. And it was a message from my boss saying, don't bother coming back.
He was pissed off. He fired you. So what did the doctor... So what was the diagnosis from the doctor?
That I had some kind of muscular disease that I didn't know what it was called at the time. And I got sicker. And I couldn't work. I had money in the bank that I saved from... What do they call that? That when you work for somebody, they put money away for you.
401k?
I dipped into my 401k. I wiped it out. Had no more money left. Welfare, food stamps, all that stopped. I had to run to my mother and father like a baby, or I would have been homeless.
And they were in Florida? They retired in Florida?
Yeah. So I came here to live.
Where in Florida?
I'm in Delray Beach.
Is that near Boca Raton?
Yes, it is.
That's between Seinfeld. His parents retired.
Yeah, so I stayed here. My mother and father divorced. I lived with my mother. I applied for disability. They turned me down.
Why'd they turn you down?
Because that's what they do. If you ask anybody that ever got disability, they turn you down automatically. You have to have a lawyer. I finally got a lawyer the third time. I waited a year for a court case. I went down to,
Florida?
I went to Jacksonville.
Jacksonville's where I grew up.
I had to go to a courthouse there. After waiting a year to get a hearing, I hired a lawyer. He met me at the courthouse. He gave me papers. He showed me what they were going to say I can do or I can't do. Their whole job is to prove they'll find something for you to be able to work at.
Right.
So they don't have.
they find anything?
5 minutes I was in the courtroom. It was just the judge, me, the lawyer, our independent doctor that wasn't mine or his,
right.
And then someone whose job is to tell people what they can and cannot do to work.
Uh-huh.
And the judge looked at the notes. He asked me my name. He said, "Your name?" I said, "Richard Fusey." He says, "How old are you?" I told him. He said, "Okay." And he talked to the doctor and he talked to my lawyer. He goes, "What is this Mr. Fusey here for?" It says here he has a type of Parkinson's. What are they doing? What are they doing, those pencil pushes? He shouldn't be in my office, in my courtroom right now. He said, "Disability. That's it. Goodbye."
Rolled in your favor.
Yeah. And my lawyer came out and said, the judge is granting you disability. And because the state of Florida took so long.
I get back disability.
By turning me down when I was legitimately sick and had plenty of ammunition going in, you know, to win my case, they had to pay me $65,000.
Ah, well, that's good.
That was all my back pay that I would have gotten from them if they granted me disability.
Yeah, you showed when them, fuck them.
Yeah, so I bought a place in a community called Kings Point. I don't know if you ever heard of it.
That's in near Boca Raton?
There's one there, but there's also one here in Delray.
Okay, Delray. That's on the east coast of Florida, right?
No, actually, it's south. It's south.
Yeah, it's south Florida, but it's on the east coast, not on the Gulf side. It's on the Atlantic
right.
side.
So I bought myself a place, but I couldn't keep it.
Huh, why not?
I couldn't live alone anymore.
Couldn't live alone, so where'd you have to, so you sold it?
I sold it. I moved in with my mother. I lived here. She took care of me for quite a long time. Meanwhile, I got diagnosed with a form of Parkinson's. Uh-huh. I started medication. I got my disability. And I was living here 5 years already. When one day my mother said, "My chest is bothering me." I said, "What do you want me to do, Mom?" She said, "Take me, I'll call an ambulance." She said, "No, take me to the hospital." So I drove her to the hospital. I waited, the doctor came out. "Your mother needs a triple bypass surgery." She had a triple bypass surgery. It worked out fine. It was a success. They put her in a rehab, you know, to get better.
Right.
She stroked out.
Died in rehab?
Yeah.
So you were living in your mom's house. So your mom owned a house?
Yeah.
So she died. So now you're living in your mom's house?
Yes, I own it. And I also had to go and fight the state of Florida to get help.
To get a nurse, you mean?
Yeah, they said, "No, you have too much money. When you don't have money, come back to us."
Uh-huh.
Well, I got rid of the money.
Did you have insurance, health insurance?
The state of Florida gave me from the healthcare district of Palm Beach County. They gave me free medical because I had nothing. And I was living under my mother's roof. And if my mother didn't take me, I'd be homeless. So they accepted me. But the bottom line is that my mom passed away.
Uh-huh.
I inherited the house. And while my mother was here, my mother lasted in an almost vegetative state in the house for 2.5 years.
So you had Parkinson's. You needed a nurse, but you were having to nurse your mom.
Yeah, and then my mother got a full-time aide who helped me.
Oh, so the nurse had to help nurse you and your mom.
Yeah, but they weren't getting paid to help me. They just did it because they were being nice and I was in the house.
Uh-huh.
when my mother died, I inherited the house, but her aides had to leave because they were paid to take care of my mother, not me.
So you had to take care of yourself?
For a while, I had to pay out of pocket to have somebody come here every day. I now have a live-in person. I don't pay a penny.
The state pays?
Yes. And the worst part is, I'm only allowed to have, at any time, in a bank account, $2,200.
Uh-huh. So where does the money come from that goes into your bank account? That's disability?
Yes.
So but what did you take it? You just had cash in your mattress or something?
That sort of thing. But my father died a year ago. My father left $2.2 million.
Uh-huh.
I can't have any of it.
Who'd he leave it to?
Me and my sister. I'm not allowed to have money under my name.
So your sister has the money?
Yeah.
You think she's going to screw you for it?
Luckily, I don't have that kind of relationship that you hear about where brothers and sisters never talk to each other again.
So you guys are close.
Oh, yes.
So does she give you cash and stuff?
Every month. If I want money. If I need to buy something, she buys it for me. If she bought me a new TV. She bought me a home theater system. I just have to ask her, but I can't have the money. Right.
Otherwise, you won't get any disability or health insurance.
They will. The day they find out I have money in the bank over what I'm allowed, everything.
Yeah.
This is the way the government works.
Yep.
We will help you when you have no more money left.
Right.
So that's the story.
How old is your sister?
68.
Oh, she's older than you.
Yeah.
She lives there too in the same city as you?
No, my sister lives in Venice, five blocks from the beach.
Venice, California?
Yeah. Huh. And my nephew has a home in Alameda or Allens.
Alameda, California?
No, I don't remember the name. It's Altadena.
Altadena, okay. So she sends you cash in the mail, or how does she wire you money or something?
She wires me $1,000 every month to supplement my.
Well, that's good. And you just keep the cash, you just take the cash. You don't let anybody know you have it.
No.
Just for in case feds happen to be listening, this is actually not Richard Fucci on the show. This is a guy named John Schwartz.
That's a hypothetical story anyway.
Yeah, exactly.
There's no truth in it.
Exactly. We're doing a parody here.
Yes.
So go ahead.
My nephew is in the music business.
Uh-huh.
My nephew made hip-hop beats.
Uh-huh.
He remixed for the Beastie Boys.
Oh, he did?
Yes. He made a beat when he was 16 years old. And it was just laying around on a tape. Somehow Eminem, his people, heard it. And they bought it from him.
Huh.
And it's on the Marshall Mathers 2 album. That was hip-hop album of the year.
So he got a good payday for that.
Oh, yeah. Big one.
He's your nephew, you said?
Yeah.
Well, good for him. Where does he live?
In California.
Oh, so he lives with your sister.
No, my nephew is married. He has two girls and one boy. They're 3, 6, and 8.
Uh-huh.
And his wife is a web designer.
Uh-huh.
And he worked doing beats, and then after he got married, he decided to get into another business, and he worked for a company that does commercials for DVDs. He does the editing of the what do you call them?
The trailers.
Trailers. Yeah. He does trailers.
Right.
He sings. He has the guy who does the voiceover go into a booth, and he has to watch the screen and sync it so that when you see it, it looks right.
Right. He's an editor. Well, that's good. Well, good for
and
him.
They have a farm.
They have a farm in California. Oh, that's nice. So that's not
in his backyard. He's got goats, chickens, rabbits. And my other nephew plays trumpet. He's professional.
They're both there. So you have one sibling.
I have a sister who's a musician. That's what she does for a living. She plays guitar, but she plays Brazilian and Spanish acoustic guitar.
Uh-huh.
And both her sons were in the music business. Well, and my mother was a music teacher and played piano and guitar.
And you played guitar as well, right?
Not good, but I played.
Yeah. And you seem to be extremely knowledgeable. So what are some of the concerts you saw in New York? The first one was Mountain.
I can tell you.
1970. Did you see the original Alice Cooper group?
Yes, with Blood Rock.
So that would have been before Love It to Death, right?
Pretty's for You, I think, was that.
Yeah, Pretty's for You. That's before Love It to Death. So that was before Bob Ezrin came in. That was before they were popular.
He was a special added attraction.
Uh-huh.
He was not even the main. It was Alice Cooper, a group called Glass Harp, and Blood Rock, who were big because of that DOA song at the time.
I remember. That's a heavy tune too. I mean, that's like one of the original metal or heart, you know, heavy rock tunes.
Yeah, but Alice, I had never seen him. My friend's older brother played the record for us twice.
I think I have that Blood Rock record in my collection up here on vinyl. I should pull that out for the vinyl track of the week next time.
Okay. And Alice, even back then when I saw him with the regular Alice Cooper group, he already had a stage act. He didn't have as many props. But I remember that the house lights went out. There was no lights on the stage. Yeah. And all you was banging on the floor.
Yeah.
A loud bang. And the lights just started to dim. To get brighter and brighter and brighter. And
Alice, that wasn't Black Juju, was it?
It could be, because all I know is he had mallets in both hands.
Could have been Black Juju.
And he was hitting the stage floor with the mallets. And then it was, from then on, I was blown away.
Yeah.
Never saw guys with hair down to the floor.
Yeah. Did you read any of their books, Dennis Dunaway's or Michael Bruce or Alice Cooper's book?
I have it. I didn't start it yet.
Which one?
I saw Neil Smith's band in concert.
I didn't know. Oh, okay. I didn't know Neil Smith had a band.
Yeah, the Neil Smith band.
Which book have you? Do you have which one do you have? The Dennis Dunaway book.
I have that, and I also have Alice's book.
Me Alice.
I guess that's what it's called.
No, he's got Golf Monster, but there's a book that came out in the early 70s or mid 70s when he had Welcome to My Nightmare. After he went solo, he did a book called Me Alice.
No, I have right now.
If you have the hardcover version of Me Alice, that book is worth a lot of money.
No, everything I have is basically audiobooks.
Right. Yeah. I don't think Me Alice is available in an audiobook.
No.
I have a PDF of that. That's actually bonus content on one of the Rock and Roll Geek on the app. Could be episode 400. I don't remember, but one of the episodes, there's bonus content where you can download the PDF of Me Alice.
I'm trying to think who I saw after Alice Cooper. I have seen so many groups there. I saw.
Where was that show?
It was at the Fillmore.
Oh, Fillmore East. Okay.
Alice played the Fillmore, and he came back a second time. I saw Humble Pie.
With Frampton.
Yes, twice there.
Wow.
Once it was Humble Pie and this group Cactus, which was
Mike Panera.
Tim, well, he was later on, but it was two guys from Vanilla Fudge.
Carmine Appice, and who else?
Tim Bogart.
Okay.
Then there was a guy, Rusty Day, from Ted Nugent's Amboy Dukes. Early band.
Wow.
And guy Jim McCarty, who played with Mitch Ryan.
And the Rockets as well.
And the Rockets, who were good.
Yeah.
Originally, Jeff Beck was supposed to be a member of Cactus, but he got in a car accident.
Beck, Bogart, and Appice.
Well, eventually they got together, yes, and Beck, Bogart, and Appice. But originally, Jeff Beck was supposed to be in Cactus.
Wow.
And he was hurt. It took him a year to recover. They didn't want to wait, so they got Jim McCarty.
I didn't know Jim McCarty played in Cactus. It's good knowledge.
Yeah, he's
Jim
good.
McCarty is a legend. You know, that's why, that's where, I think he played in Gibson Birdland, I'm pretty sure. Because I think that's where Ted Nugent, I could be wrong, but I think that's where Ted Nugent got the Birdland idea from.
Yeah, I saw Cactus play at the Fillmore. Once they were the headliners, Humble Pie was the...
they were support.
Support.
Oh, Steve Marriott. Then, that's a good bill.
Then I saw this guy named Lee Michaels.
That name sounds familiar. I don't know. I'm not that familiar.
With Humble Pie. A second time. I was at one of the shows that was recorded for the live album.
Oh, okay. Humble Pie was live at the Fillmore East, too. Isn't that what
It's called Performance. I was at one of the shows.
See, now I would have put that in one of my top live albums, but that was a little bit before my time. That's why I didn't put, because I did a top 10 live albums, and that was not in there because that was a little bit before my time. But that's widely considered one of the great live albums.
It is a very good album. I was at the Allman Brothers when they recorded. Then I was at a concert for Johnny Winter when he played with Rick Derringer.
And Johnny Winter and live or captured live? Was it captured live? Captured Live is a fucking great live album. He was one of the greatest guitar players ever too.
Yeah,
you saw Johnny. I saw Johnny Winter at the Warfield here. He was doing blues then.
I shared a story on the Geek Show before. Maybe you didn't read it.
About seeing Johnny Winter on Capture Live.
No, I sat next to him on an airplane to Los Angeles.
Oh, did you talk his ear off?
No, I was respectful. I was sitting in first class. Because I had gotten mileage, and in the old days, if you got mileage, you can turn it in for like a free ticket or an upgrade. I said, let me upgrade. It's a 5.5-hour trip.
Right.
I get on the plane. I sit down, mind my own business. I'm reading Guitar World magazine. I turn my head. I'm on the aisle seat. I see a guy with white hair, pink eyes. I said, what the fuck? There's no way. That can't be. I said, it is. That's Johnny. You're fucking Johnny Winter. Right across the aisle from me.
You didn't say anything to him?
I got up. I took a pen. I took my Guitar Player magazine. I said, hey, Johnny, would you mind? He goes, no, what's your name? I told him. He signed my Guitar Player magazine. He said, he didn't write anything special. He Richard Johnny Winter. I said, Johnny, thank you so much. I love your music. I saw you play so many times. He said, thank you very much.
Did he have his manager with him, or was by himself?
He had people. He had people with him. I said, he said to me, what do you drink? I said, what do you mean? He says, what do you drink?
He's going to buy you a drink.
I said, I usually drink rum and coke. He says, excuse me, And he called over the stewardess. He said, could you get my friend a rum and coke? Yeah,
even though you get free drinks in first class.
I know, but he...
But he ordered you one.
Yeah, he ordered it for me.
Well, that was nice of him.
And he was downing vodka and orange juice like we drink water and going to the bathroom so many times.
What year was this?
Shit. It had to be in
the 70s?
Late 70s, early 80s.
Okay, so it was after that. So he was probably already starting to play blues then.
When I saw him, I think he was finished with his rock. He got into the rock for a while.
Yeah. Well, if for people who don't know, that Captured Live album and Still Alive and Well and Boney Maroney. Listen to a live version of Boney Maroney from Captured Live.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Do I have that? Let me see.
You know, if you really want to hear a really fine album, there's an album called Second Winter. It's a double album with only music on three sides. Because Johnny, we ran out of tunes.
Huh. Yes.
So it's a double album with only music on three of the sides, but it's a great album.
I can't believe I don't have any Johnny Winter because I had a hard drive crash. And lost all my songs and all the Johnny Winter I have. I have Johnny Winter Captured Live on vinyl up there on the shelf. I got a few Johnny Winter up there on vinyl. I have to pull that out for a vinyl track of the week, too. But anybody who wants to hear some great guitar playing, listen to Johnny Winter on Captured Live.
Yeah. With that, what did he play? A Firebird? A Thunderbird?
Yeah, Firebird.
Yeah.
Yep, he was a badass.
He was.
He said, I remember this interview he did.
I saw him with his brother.
Oh, Johnny and Edgar Winter, yeah. Yeah, I'm not a big Edgar Winter fan.
No, it wasn't Johnny. It was called Johnny Winter and Edgar Winter's White Trash.
Yeah, okay, yeah. Oh, you mean it was a double bill?
Yes.
They weren't on stage together.
But they did play a song or two together.
Yeah.
They were billed separately.
Who else did you see?
I've seen Led Zeppelin. Oh, you don't like Zeppelin.
Oh, you saw Zeppelin. Okay. I never saw Led Zeppelin.
First row center, Madison Square Garden.
Was that Song Remains the Same filming?
75?
That was probably around when Song Remains the Same came out, wasn't it? Maybe that was about 77, maybe.
Yeah. No, I saw them in 75 and 77. I was in high school, and a friend of mine, he went to Madison Square Garden with a sleeping bag and some food.
Huh.
And he camped out overnight. As soon as they opened up at 6:30 a.m., the box office, he was fifth in line. And he got first row tickets for three nights that they played there.
Was it Song Remains the Same came out in 76. So you might have saw him on the filming of Song Remains the Same if you saw him in 75.
Yeah, that's when I saw them at the Garden.
Yeah, I think that's where it was filmed.
It was one of my...
No, wait a minute, I'm wrong. The filming took place in the summer of 73 at a series of concerts in Madison Square Garden.
Okay. That was not the first time I saw them. I saw them in 75.
Okay.
And then 77, but...
Go ahead.
I sat first row center the first time I saw Led Zeppelin. Because of him camping out. And then the second time I saw Led Zeppelin, I went with my girlfriend. I had nosebleed seats.
70, you know, nose... 77. That would have been... what album would that have been on?
I think the four. Oh, no.
In Through the Out. No. Presence. That would have been Presence. Presence came out in 76. Yeah, but I'm not a huge Led Zeppelin fan, to tell you the truth.
I know the kind of music you like.
I mean, I liked Led Zeppelin when I was in high school, but it was like they were kind of the snob, the rock snobs.
Yeah, and they called them dinosaurs.
They called Zeppelin dinosaurs. Well,
in other words, they're extinct, they were saying.
No, the rock snobs, they thought, because Zeppelin was like a tasteful music. And I was into bands like Kiss and Cheap Trick and Aerosmith.
I love that too, though.
Yeah, some of the people in my school were snobs, and they like, of course I have some Led Zeppelin, because if you're a rock fan, you had to have Led Zeppelin. But just deep down inside, I really wasn't a huge fan. Plus, John Paul Jones, those fucking bass parts he plays are so difficult to play.
Yeah.
As a bass player, I kind of resent that.
I like my guitar players that do technical stuff the same way I like my bass players. That's why I really like a guy like Billy Sheehan.
Uh-huh. Yeah, okay. He wears his bass too high. Are you a Pete? Do you like Pete Way?
Yes, of course.
So that's because you're a UFO fan.
Oh, yeah.
Do you have that Pete Way book? The picture book that Ross Halfen put out recently.
No.
Yeah, Chuck Spear, friend of the show, sent it to me as a Christmas gift, and I just got it. It came to me like February.
You've seen him live, right?
UFO? Oh, yeah. I saw UFO open for Styx. It was Styx, UFO, and Ram Jam on the Pieces of Eight tour. I'm pretty sure it was Pieces of Eight. So that would have been, Obsession? Could have been before. It was before the live album. So Schenker was still in the band. They opened up with Electric Phase.
That's my favorite song.
Yeah, it could have been Lights Out Tour.
I like Victims of Illusion, but that's not UFO.
What's Victims of Illusion? Is that Pete Way?
MSG.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh, yeah. You sent me that song.
I did.
Live song. You want to hear that song? Should we play it soon? Yeah. We've been 51 minutes. We haven't played one song.
Let's play.
Okay. I got to pull up the Richard Fucci playlist. I'm getting Facebook messages from people now because they found out that we're doing the show, so they decided to interrupt.
But they can't hear it, right?
No, they can't hear it. I'm not doing this live. I never do the Rock and Roll Geek Show live because I get...
And you're editing out our conversations that has nothing to do with them, right?
What?
Do you edit out any of the conversation if you feel it doesn't flow right?
No, I don't edit anything.
Oh, I thought you did.
No. No, sorry. All right, I have. Are you pissed off now because I'm not editing anything out? Because nothing here has been boring. It's been all interesting to me.
That's fine with me.
This 52 minutes has flown by as far as I'm concerned. I'm finding you quite interesting.
And there's a lot of things I can't even recall right now.
I would go out on a limb and say you're one of the most interesting people I've had on the show. I think so, man. You've seen it all.
I've seen plenty.
All right, I have. What's that? Go ahead.
Both good and bad, I've seen.
That's called living, friend.
Yeah, I've made some mistakes in life. That
if all you saw was good, it wouldn't be an interesting life.
I know, but a lot of the people I ran with, they're dead.
Yeah. Yes. Same with me. Unfortunately, that happens.
I was very lucky that I got smart at the right time.
You mean smart by stopping doing drugs?
I was doing heroin.
Oh, really? What year was that?
When did Rocks come out?
That was around 76, 75.
Yeah, that would be that period. When Rock, I had two albums. I had Rainbow Rising and Aerosmith Rocks. That's all I had.
I saw Aerosmith on the Rocks tour.
And I lived in a basement. I could tell you stories, Michael.
About doing heroin?
Yeah, and about how I got the money for the heroin. And it's not through sex, but...
Oh, I was going to say, did you have to do things like Dee Dee Ramone did?
No, I would shoot myself first. But I'm not homophobic.
Uh-huh. The thought of putting a penis in your mouth, would you'd rather die.
I'm sick.
So what did you have to do for money then? Kill people?
We shoplifted.
So you shoplifted things and sold it so you could get money for heroin.
Yes.
That's not that bad.
And I used to take my friend, and we used to drive from Long Island to what's called the Bronx, the South.
Yeah, where Richard Manitoba's from, Handsome Dick Manitoba.
We the only white people there.
Oh, yeah, yep. We had to score.
I'd cop, and then there was sometimes that you would have dealers that would tell you, I have a place for you if you want to go. And,
right, shooting galleries, what they were called.
Yep. But I didn't like to do that. I was, what do you call it? I didn't shoot heroin for a year.
You smoked it or snorted it?
I snorted it for a year, and then finally the people that pressured me said, man, you're missing the rush.
Right. So you started shooting it.
Yeah, and then mixing coke and dope.
Uh-oh, speedballing.
Yes. And also doing crazy things like shooting dope in the South Bronx, and then getting in my car and driving back home to Long Island, driving and hanging my head out the window.
To stay awake, to keep you from nodding out.
And puking, yeah. The better the dope, the more you puke.
Huh. That sounds like a great time.
Yeah, well, I'm just done plenty. And I didn't get away with it because I got hepatitis C from the needles.
So you still have hepatitis?
No, I was treated with medication that came out a long time ago, and it's no longer detected in my body.
Well, that's good.
But
how did you kick the heroin?
How did I what?
How'd you get off the heroin?
Oh, my friends got on a methadone program.
Uh-huh. Well, you can get addicted to methadone just as much as you get addicted to heroin.
But they gave me methadone. My friend would give me like every Friday and Saturday, I'd take like 20 milligrams of methadone. And then you take some, what they call amitriptyline. It's called Elavil.
Uh-huh.
You take it together.
And that would get the you do that until the heroin got out of your bloodstream, and then you're no longer.
Yeah, but I didn't go. I wasn't shooting every day. I was a weekender.
So you weren't really addicted then, if you were just doing it on weekends.
They called it a chippy.
A what?
A chippy. It's an expression. It means you're not quite addicted.
You're dabbled.
But you dabble, and every weekend your body kind of like says, "Ooh, where is my dope?"
Right. So your body would get used to being high every week, and if you didn't get high every week, you'd jones and have withdrawals?
Yeah. By the weekend, yeah.
Huh. That's weird how the body figured that out.
And, you believe it or not, a little bit after that, I discovered that I couldn't control myself. I was going from doctor to doctor, getting scripts. And I finally,
opioids?
Yeah. I finally decided one day, I said, you know what? I'm not going to make it. It's just 50 if I keep this up. And so I joined Narcotics Anonymous. I got clean for a year, relapsed. 18 months, relapse, 3 years, relapse, and then I never went back, but on my own,
What made you want to start doing heroin? Was it a rock star that you looked up to?
No, I guess peer pressure from the people that I was hanging with.
I guess in New York.
I was smoking weed. I was doing mescaline, I was doing acid, I was doing Quaaludes. I used to buy Quaaludes for $1 a piece at the park.
Yeah, I used to do Quaaludes and Placidils.
Yeah, my mother had the green ones. So let me
Placidils?
Yeah, they had the red ones and the green ones.
I would puke on those every time and black out.
You know, it made you feel like you were drunk.
Oh, yeah, it made me just black out.
Yeah, well, but basically, now, I only take what I'm allowed to take.
So, wait a minute. Now you only take what you're allowed to take?
Yeah, I'm on. I have weed.
Uh huh.
And my doctor gave me oxycodone.
You're on oxycodone. You know that's an opioid. That's pretty much the same as heroin.
Yeah, I know. But I need it legitimately.
All right. Well, you're back hooked.
Back then, it was for the just for the high.
Right. So you're back. You're not clean anymore. You're hooked again.
No, I'm not clean. No.
Yeah, my mom was addicted to oxycodone. My wife was. She checked herself into rehab. She was addicted to oxycodone.
I went for 7 days to detox because a doctor gave me something called fentanyl.
That'll kill you.
Well, I was on fentanyl.
I didn't know doctors prescribed fentanyl. I thought that was what the Chinese people cut their heroin with.
No, it's a fentanyl is a man-made manufactured.
Yeah, that'll kill you.
And I had a patch. I wore a patch that put it into your transdermal. It goes through your skin.
You're not still taking fentanyl, are you?
No, I told the doctor. I said, no more fentanyl for me. I'm reading bad things about it. He goes, well, you've been on it too long. You can't kick it at home. I'm going to have to put you in rehab.
What these fucking doctors, man? Their doctors are fucking the doctors are the worst drug dealers of all.
He put me in detox for 7 days. It was a madhouse.
I mean, I would think that's grounds for malpractice suit.
But it's not because he's a pain management doctor.
So you got cleaned up off of fentanyl, and now you're back on oxycodone?
Yeah, but the fentanyl was like 5 years ago.
So what's the oxycodone? What's the pain that you have?
I have muscle contractions.
Due to Parkinson's?
Yes. And sometimes my muscles, they tense up.
Uh-huh.
But they don't relax. So just think of
like you got a stiff neck. If you got a stiff neck and it's like,
yeah, it won't go away.
Right. Yeah, that's pretty painful. So the oxycodone will make it relax. It will seem like the pot would.
I take pot. I smoke reefer at night.
Only at night to go to sleep.
Yeah. And the oxycodone I take in the morning, and it's good for a few hours. My doctor told me 10 years ago, or almost 10 years ago, your disease usually progresses, so you can expect 8 years to be alive.
So he told you 10 years ago you got 8 years to live?
Yes.
You outlived him by two. How long are they giving you a prognosis now?
They said every case that like mine is different. And that it all depends on if the disease progresses to the other side of my body.
Uh-huh. Well, man, do me a favor and don't die anytime soon. You know, I've had there's been like three or four friends of the Rock and Roll, maybe even more close friends of the Rock and Roll Geek Show who have passed away. I don't need, just hang in there for a lot longer,
you don't
please.
Lose any more listeners.
What?
You want those donations to keep coming. You can't lose.
It's not even the donations. I can't afford to lose any listeners, period. And if just friends of the show, I mean, I become friends. All the people who Rock and Roll Geek Show listeners, I consider friends. And I've made some good friends. And some of these people have died and made me very sad. So I would be very sad if anything happened to you, Richard Fucci.
Just dedicate a few songs for me.
Well, I mean, I
play a Steve Vai song, or I know
what. When you die,
if I die, I want you to play from start to finish.
Somebody, please write this down in case this happens.
I'm making a joke. I was going to tell you play Smith and Cotson from start to finish.
Yeah, okay, I'll do it. I'll do it. And don't die. Just do me a favor and don't die anytime soon, please. You don't feel like you're going to die anytime soon, do you?
I'm 65 years old. I have Parkinson's. How much more time do you think I have? Every day I think, do I have a year left? Do I have 2 years left?
Wait, do you feel okay?
at times I have my good moments when I'm relaxed and I'm pain free. And then, like putting on a light switch, all of a sudden I can start having an attack where I get warm, I get weak, I lose my breath, I can't talk. So, no.
Well, just do me a favor and hang in there for at least 10 more years.
Oh, that would be great if I knew I had 10 more years to go.
Do I need to say a prayer to the rock and roll God? Well, I can't do it while you're on the phone because that would be, could jinx it. So
wouldn't be right.
Yeah, well, I'll say, just hang in there. Don't, everybody who's listening right now, if you're listening, say a prayer before you go to bed tonight. Make sure Richard Fusey doesn't leave us anytime soon.
And I told everybody that I'm more entertaining online when I can type words than being
than talking.
I'm
entertained while you're talking. This is not how your voice I was expecting to hear. I wasn't expecting to hear a gruff New York accent. I don't know what accent I was expecting to hear. I was not expecting to hear any accent.
New York.
Yeah, you sound you got a hardcore New York accent. Deep New York's accent. New York.
You
accent.
Want a glass of water? You guys in California, my sister says water.
Water. I'm from Jacksonville, Florida, so I have a southern accent, which is not, it's kind of gone away now, but people out here recognize the accent from Florida.
Give me a quarter.
Give me a quarter.
Yeah, a quarter. There's certain words that you could tell somebody's from New York.
Yeah. No, you got a deep New York accent. I can hear the accent. You sound like Manitoba. My friend Manitoba, he's got a super deep accent.
No, I went to a concert at this place I used to go after the Fillmore closed down called the Academy.
Uh-huh. I played there. I played there.
Yeah,
Didn't it become Beacon Theater?
No, the Beacon Theater is on Broadway.
Okay, I played the Beacon Theater when I was in Exodus.
Yeah, I like that album that I was playing because it said did you actually record that album with them?
What album? Force of Habit?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm on that album. It's a good album, isn't it?
I love it.
It's different than all their other albums.
It's very heavy. Yeah. And there's this that I posted. It starts off with a bass run. I like it a lot.
It starts off with Thorn in My Side, doesn't it? Or it starts off with Force of Habit.
I don't remember which song I put up, but one of them, it starts off with bass. And then a really great riff comes in.
Yeah, that's me on bass. Yeah, that album, they're ashamed of that album, but I think
you were in the same band as Kurt Hammett.
Yeah, not at the same time.
I know that, but still.
Now I'm back in a band with the singer for Exodus again.
And who is Gary Holt?
Gary Holt's the guitar player.
Didn't he take over for Henneman when he died?
Yeah, he played with Slayer for the past few years.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Gary Holt's a rock star. And he is Exodus. There would be no Exodus without Gary Holt. It's all his music. I got to close this door. Hold on.
How about giving some music to the people?
What's that?
How about giving some music to the people?
Okay, you want to hear the play Victim of Illusion?
Anything from the list in any order you want.
Okay, we'll play Victim of Illusion. This is from Tokyo, night 2016. This is the only one I have of Victim.
I think I like that one a lot.
You like that one?
Pardon?
What's that?
Is it?
It's Michael Schenker Fest.
Oh, it's the fest. Okay.
I think Gary Barton's singing on it. All right.
I don't know if Barton or McCauley sings. Oh, look.
Featuring Gary Barton, is what it says.
Okay.
I like Gary Barton. He's off key, but I like him. I saw the Schenker Fest. It was quite entertaining.
You're going to make me cry.
Why? He didn't come down to Florida?
I would love to. I can't go to concerts.
You never saw UFO?
Yeah, I did.
What tour did you see UFO on?
I saw UFO when he was doing Space Child.
Oh, before the old UFO.
Yeah.
That was when we were playing hippie music. Yep. Hippie version of UFO. All right, here's
Go ahead.
All right, here's Victim of Illusion 2016. Here we go. Can you hear it okay, Fusey?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm happy.
Talking to me, Richard?
No, I'm saying, Michael, get with the solo.
Okay. Telling me to kill it?
Yeah, I like when you say it.
Oh, okay. You want me to kill it?
Kill it! Kill it!
Okay.
That's it. That made my day.
All right. Can I bet? I'm gonna let it roll. Gary Barton's got to be one of the worst singers in rock, but I like the guy. Take it away, Michael! Go, man! Thank you. Thank you. Okay.
Kill it.
Okay. You know, guitar players always say, when they talk about Jeff Beck, how great Jeff Beck is, they say he keeps getting better. He keeps improving. So does Michael Schenker, you know.
Yes, he's better than he was ever.
I think he's one of the greatest guitar players of all time. And does not, I know he gets recognition from music geeks, but I don't think he gets enough recognition for being such a fantastic guitar player. He really is a...
You ask anybody that is famous, that plays guitar in rock, 95% of them will mention him.
Yeah. The guy he's not only, first of all, he's a total original. His style is unmistakably original. And the guy just is, and he's...
You know what it's all about?
He's like a mad genius, the guy.
He's melodic.
He's what?
Very melodic.
Oh, yeah. His melodic solos, you know, he can shred, but when he plays the melodic stuff, like... What song is it? Mother Mary? Stuff...
Yeah.
He's fucking great, man. I've seen him so many times, and every time I see him, he gets better on it. He plays better.
And he also is true to his style of music. Yeah. He wants,
you know why? He doesn't listen to other music.
Right. I've heard that. I've also heard that he said, I didn't need to join Black Sabbath when they called me, or Ozzy when they called me. That's not for me, he said.
Yeah, I do my own thing.
I don't need the fame. I don't need the money. Yeah. I need to be myself.
You got to admire that in the guy.
I do. He's also was a nutcase.
No, he's a complete nutcase. But that's what most geniuses are nutcases, though.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. Well, are you a nutcase?
Yeah.
According to Joe Pollack, maybe. And Dave Slusher. What do you think of Dave Slusher?
Dave Slusher?
Yeah.
I got to write something down. Hold on. Yeah. I got to write
something down. There's Richard Fucci humor.
I like him, even though I complained because he didn't upload the show fast enough.
And he said, fuck you.
I had to be, I was with dad or something.
Right. He said, fuck yourself.
I had more important things than to worry about. You. I have to wait for the show to go.
Yeah, that's...
You know, everybody knows that I'm sarcastic, but it's in a humorous way.
Well, one time I was 35 feet up on a ladder painting a house. This was about a year ago. I'm 35 feet up on a ladder, and I come down, and I'm painting all day, busting my ass. I wasn't even painting, I was scraping. Scraping a fucking house 35 feet up. And I come down like 4 hours later, and I see all these Facebook messages from you. And you go, you don't answer me. I guess that means I'm right about my thoughts about you. You're sexist. I was either sexist or racist. I think I was racist. I'm like, holy shit, man. I've been on the ladder scraping for 4 hours. I'm sorry for not answering.
I remember that. I remember
it was you were pissed at me, man.
Something you said at Mad at Dad.
You got to understand, Mad at Dad, I'm trying to make I'm trying to do comedy. I'm pulling shit out of my fucking inner asshole to try to make funny. Try to make.
By the way, you are funny.
Trying to make a show mildly entertaining. Otherwise, it's going to be, well, I had breakfast this week and
I know.
So don't take anything I say on Mad at Dad personally, because I'm just trying to be entertaining. I'm just trying to be funny.
You succeed. I get some good laughs out of your shows. And you have shows that I will listen to over and over and over again.
Huh. On Mad at Dad, you'll listen over and over again?
Right.
Okay.
Wait a minute. I can't say that because that the one called something with Ozzy shaking it or something.
Oh, when Ozzy called in to the show.
I love it.
Oh, because he, oh, because, yeah, that didn't offend you. I thought that might have offended you because after Ozzy called in, I thought about it. I said, uh-oh, wait a minute.
You Richard, said to me, you don't want me to put it up, I won't.
Oh, did I say that before we posted it? Yeah, I think I felt bad after. I felt maybe that might have been insensitive. That was Casey doing Ozzy. What a fucking asshole.
I didn't know who it was. He was good. He was funny.
Ozzy doesn't have Parkinson's, does he? Oh, that's fun. I'm glad you got it. I'm glad you didn't get offended by that. Yeah, I thought afterwards, I went, well, Minion, that might have been insensitive. I really don't want Richard Fusey to think we were making fun of him or anything. Because I don't know why I would even think you were making fun of you. Because I don't know the symptoms of Parkinson's, so I don't know. But for some reason, I thought maybe you would get offended by it. So I figured I would ask you.
I repeatedly listened to that. And I think I guess because I'm a big Judas Priest fan. But when you did... The newest one. What was it?
Oh, the track by track of what's the name of the last song? Of the last Firepower. Album? Firepower. Yeah.
I loved it.
Well, good. I'm glad.
That was great. Not only was it great, but you were also very amusing when you were trying to say, that's KK. I mean, that's Faulkner.
When I did that track by track, was that, no, the which one was the first one that Richie Faulkner was on? I think he wasn't on Nostradamus. So the album,
the one after, the one before that, after that.
I was trying to guess who played on that album or who played the solo, and I got an instant message from Richie Faulkner the next day.
Oh wow!
Said that he listened to the track by track, and he and his friends were laughing because I got every solo wrong. Who was playing it?
But it was amusing.
Yeah. I was flattered that Richie Faulkner listened. I interviewed Richie Faulkner once at backstage at the Judas Priest.
I never saw them with him, and he saved that group.
Oh, yeah, of course he did. Well, anyway, I interviewed him backstage, and I forgot to push record. So there's an episode out there. I don't know if you've heard it, but... I reenact the interview. I play the part of me and Richie Faulkner.
Well, I have the app on my tablet, which gives me access to all the shows, I think.
Yeah, I think it does. So look for that one. That one seems to have been quite popular with people. What other podcaster would do that if he forgot to push record? What other podcaster do you know that would reenact a failed interview?
None.
Yeah, I think that makes me an original.
I won't mention them, but there's about four other podcasts I listen to besides you.
Go ahead, mention them.
Mitch LaFont.
You like that guy, huh?
Yeah, I listen to the Deep Purple podcast.
With Mitch LaFont?
No, another guy. I can't remember his name.
What do you like about Mitch LaFon?
No, I don't mean him. I'll tell you his name in a second. I don't want to disconnect.
So you listen to Mitch LaFon, you listen to the Deep Purple podcast. You're not talking about Martin Popoff, are you?
No. I'm going to tell you right now. I don't want to lose you very soon. Hello? Hello?
Yeah, I'm here. Hello?
I don't want to give free
publicity. Stuff.
Yeah, but I listen to Rock Talk.
Rock Talk with Mitch LaFon.
The Deep Purple podcast.
Uh-huh.
Two guys do it.
Uh-huh.
The History in Five Songs with Martin Popoff.
Okay. He's okay. I don't listen to other music shows, but I got nothing against Martin Popoff. He's been on my show.
The Classic Rock Podcast.
Classic Rock Podcast or Classic Metal Show?
Nope. It's called the Classic Rock
Podcast. Classic Rock Podcast. What's that host's name?
I don't know.
I bet you none of them make you smile or laugh more than the Rock and Roll Geek Show, right?
Of course not.
These guys all try to be professional sounding. They try to put on what?
No guitar is safe.
No guitar is safe. Okay.
That's another podcast I listen to.
Never heard of that one. Okay.
And there's a porno place.
Porno place?
Yeah, it's a thing. I forgot what it's called.
A pornography podcast?
It's not really a pornography. It's an adult. They interview adult stars.
They interview porn stars.
Yes.
Okay. That's not Holly Randall, is it?
Yes, it is.
You listen to Holly Randall's podcast?
Yes.
Yeah, I listen to her podcast too. She's not a good interviewer.
Her mother was famous.
Yeah, I know. I subscribe to Holly Randall's podcast, and I don't know why, because every time I listen, I say, man, she's not a good interviewer. She's sincere. She tries. But she likes to talk about herself. Well, that me accusing somebody of that, that's pretty hypocritical, I guess. Yeah. But what other podcasts will make you laugh like mine? I think I'm an original. You disagree. You disagree, huh?
No. You're the best podcaster that I've ever heard.
There's
no other podcast that I run to my phone on the weekend to want to check to see, did Michael do a show yet?
Well, good, because I'm honest and I have a sense of humor. I don't take myself seriously, and I have no trouble saying if something sucks, I'll say it sucks. I don't try to kiss people's ass so that I can get them on my podcast.
I noticed that,
and I don't try to. All these other music podcasters, they want to sound, they're like a professional radio show. Fuck those guys.
You mean like your friend Eddie?
Well, I'm jealous of Eddie Trunk. I'm not going to say.
Why? Because I could be doing that too, I feel.
Yeah, he's paid his dues, so, but I'd still listen to his serious show, but the guy name drops. I texted him last week. We texted. Oh, I texted Tom Peterson. When I found out Tom Peterson had heart surgery, I texted him, and he got right back to me. Fuck you. Yeah, but I listen to Eddie Trunk's show still.
But he talks about the same people over and over.
That guy, John Five, annoys the shit out of me, man.
He's a great guitarist.
I don't care. I told you, I'll audition for Ozzy, and he was the guitar player.
John Five is his friend.
Yeah. John Five, the guy from Rage Against the Machine, is his good friend.
Ace
is his dear friend. Yeah, he had Ace and John 5 on. Whoopty fucking dude. That John 5, shut your mouth, John 5, let Ace talk.
I don't listen to the show for Eddie Trunk. I listen to it for the people he has on.
How about when people call in? He's got to have he must have the stupidest callers.
But they all sound like they come from the sticks out.
They sound like they're morons.
Or they...
Hey, Eddie, whatever happened to Kicks?
Yeah.
Hey, Eddie, man, that new Struts album, you were right. Thank you for turning me on to the Struts. Man, they're great.
And didn't you just, you did Dirty Honey and...
You like those two albums, Dirty Honey and Greta Van Fleet?
No, I liked what you did with them.
What did I do with them? Pit one against the other?
I enjoyed the things you said.
Yeah. How about writing a song? Dirty Honey. They're the future of rock. Yeah. How about writing a song instead of a bunch of riffs? How about putting a chorus in there at some point, please?
I was going to ask you about that.
What?
You seem to feel that the chorus is the most important part of a song, right?
I need to have something I can sing along to. I can sing along to Nobody's Fault. I can sing along to, oh, it's time to sing tonight. I can sing along to, that was the last child.
because when you do a track by track or a review, I always remember hearing you go, come on, get to the chorus already.
Yeah. A song needs a chorus.
And I'm a riff guy.
Well, Judas Priest, case in point, they got choruses.
And riffs.
Yeah. You can have both. Black Sabbath has choruses.
Yeah. And your favorite Judas Priest album is my least favorite.
Point of Entry? You like, that's your least favorite album, Point of Entry?
Did that have Solar Angels on it?
Oh, yeah. You better believe it.
That's the song I like a lot.
Turning Circles is the best Judas Priest song ever, and they will never play that live.
I'll go back to it. I'll try.
On Desert Plains?
Oh, I know that song, too.
Yeah. Hot Rockin'? Come on. That album's fucking great.
I can't listen to that song because it makes me...
Oh, because of the video when they're in the gym with no shirts on?
It's a little bit... Gay.
Yeah, it's a little gay. It is a little gay.
But what you care? You're a transsexual.
I'm a woman. I identify as a woman. By the way, I'm running for governor if I can just raise $4,000. I'll clean up the homeless problem in California. Make me your governor. I will end the homeless problem in 1 month.
You know that.
Guaranteed.
They're still on Venice Beach sleeping sometimes?
Not if I'm governor.
And living out of trailers that they have to move every day to
another spot? I'm governor, they won't.
Mm. Well,
all these tent cities, if I'm governor, 1 month, they'll be gone, friends. Make me governor. All needs $4,000 to enter the race.
Well, find a few more people that they're willing to pay to hear on your show, maybe it'll raise the $4,000.
Yeah, and I'll identify as a woman. I'll go head to head against what's his name, Bruce Jenner.
Bruce Jenner. There is no.
Caitlyn Jenner.
Come on, I respect.
Yeah, I know. I'm a tran. I'm a tranny. I can say that. All right, I'm not doing Mad at Dad bits on the Rock and Roll Geek Show.
Okay.
All right. So where were we?
I got to hear one song.
What else do you want? You want to hear another song?
She's a Whore.
He's a Whore. Now, a whore. In my iTunes crash, in the infamous crash of the iTunes, I lost the first Cheap Trick vinyl. I have it on vinyl up there, but there's a live album recorded at the Whiskey in 1977 called Out to Get You. Do you have that?
Nope.
It's a fucking great live album. I'll play He's a Whore from that. Okay?
Yeah.
All right. Here's He's a Whore, 1977, The Whiskey. Thank you, Michael Street, for not sending me this. Oh, I'm just like spinning beach ball here. Okay. Here we go. Okay. Hold on. Oh, wait a second. I just got another new producer, and he's fucking things up again. I don't know why I have trouble finding a good producer. Because
you don't pay him enough.
That's true. You're fired, motherfucker. Okay.
Ever seen her face? She's got a face that could stop the clock. It was a face I surely won't stop to look her in the eyes. On a money screen, like tears, sours her teeth. But she's still so close to my reach. If I call.
Are you talking to me, Richard Fusey?
I was going to ask you, is this a bonus episode?
No. Yes, this is a bonus episode. Okay. All right. And I tell it all. And I tell it all. And I tell it all. Where it goes. I think I'll take a full ride. But there's no regret from my side. I take a lousy on the red cloud. So I show my face. And I can even fake a smile. Cause I'm laughing inside of the vial. This little girl, she's a joke, she's a joke, she's a joke. And I tell it all.
man. How fucking great is that? Fuck. How great is that?
Hey, Michael.
Yeah.
How many days do you think I should stay off the page?
Off the Rock and Roll Geek Facebook group?
After they listen to this episode.
Oh, they're going to love it. They're going to love it. I just hope the rest of we didn't get as much money as people were promising, but that's okay. It doesn't matter. I'm enjoying this episode, Richard Fusey. Have you ever seen Cheap Trick live? Don't stay. You don't have to stay off the page. You'll once. I think you'll get a lot of good comments. You saw him once. When did you see Cheap Trick?
I saw Cheap Trick with the Cars, and it could have been Dream Police.
Dream Police tour. I saw Cheap Trick.
I think it was In Color, black and white, because I heard the song Big Eyes for the first time.
Okay. I saw Cheap Trick on the In Color tour, was probably 77, opening for Foreigner and Heart.
That's a nice bill.
It was Foreigner, Heart, and Cheap Trick. I'm pretty sure that was the bill. I know Foreigner was on the bill. I'm pretty sure Heart was second, was opening for Foreigner. And Cheap Trick opened the show. And as soon as Cheap Trick came on stage, I said, holy shit, this band is fucking great. Next day, I went out and bought their latest album, In Color, and they've been my favorite band ever since.
Yeah, I know you liked them a lot. But that first album, to me, is very heavy.
It's very punk. It's kind of punk rock. It's not really heavy.
It's not popish, I mean, like some of their other stuff.
There's some good pop songs on first Cheap Trick album, though.
So
you don't like the pop Cheap Trick?
I like a lot of Cheap Trick, but after a certain point, I wasn't listening to their new stuff.
Around All Shook Up is when I started to get off the track, but once I got back into them around the Red Ant, I couldn't believe I stopped listening to them. I kicked myself. I said, dude, you're a fucking poser for stop listening to Cheap Trick. So
when I saw them, they blew the Cars off the stage.
They blew everybody off the stage, Foreigner and Heart. Cars are boring live, or they were boring live. I saw Cars. Band, what's that?
They're a studio band where Rick was able to work magic in the studio and make wonderful albums, but they would stand like wooden statues. They don't move.
Yeah, except for Elliot Easton.
Yeah, he does a little bit, but I found it boring. I liked the music, and they couldn't present it like the studio version.
Yeah, I saw Cars open for somebody around the same time the first album came out.
But basically, you asked me about my favorite concert. My first concert was Mountain. My favorite concert was Blue Oyster Cult, Thin Lizzy, The Dictators, but they didn't show up.
That was Dictators didn't show?
They didn't show.
What city was this in?
At the Palladium in New York City.
Huh, I got to ask Manitoba why they canceled that show.
The Village Voice put out the ad. Blue Oyster Cult, Thin Lizzy, and The Dictators. A week later, the new Village Voice, that's a paper.
I know the paper.
Blue Oyster Cult and Thin Lizzy, no Dictators. It was the same date, same show. And I went to the show only because I heard that Gary Moore was
playing with Lizzy.
Thin Lizzy for this tour only. So I went to the Palladium with no ticket in my hand. I went outside, I walked around, there was a guy scalping tickets. I heard what he was asking for. I waited a while. Then all of a sudden, the guy goes, you need a ticket to the show? I said, yeah, it's starting soon. He goes, I got to get out of here. Give me 15 bucks. The 15 bucks, I take the ticket, I walk in, row AA center.
Front row center.
Yep.
Was Gary Moore in the band?
Yep, blew me away.
Because he quit during that tour.
Yes,
He walked off in Oakland, California. What I heard.
I heard about that. He agreed to do the tour and then he left.
Got into. I thought I heard that he got into a fist fight with Phil. backstage. Craig, the guitar player for the Butlers, knows everything about Thin Lizzy. He would tell me I'm full of shit. So,
well, I just know that.
Gary Moore and Thin Lizzy was such a good lineup.
It was all about that for me because he was fantastic. I didn't really know him that well.
Gary Moore, beyond shredder.
Yeah, I liked all his stuff, even his early stuff.
Oh, yeah.
He did a lot of different stuff. But the fact that it was First Row, I liked both bands. But Thin Lizzy, forget it. Yeah. I never saw
Thin Lizzy would have blown Blur Sicult away. Blur Sicult's not, I don't think they're the greatest live band. Well, I never saw them back then. We opened for them like 3 years ago.
I saw them when they had like five guys would come up front all playing guitar.
Yeah.
I didn't go to see, I went because it was Thin Lizzy, but I wasn't going to walk out.
Yeah. I never saw Thin Lizzy live. Well, with Phil in the band, I never saw the classic lineup of Thin Lizzy. What do you think about that Motorhead album with Brian Robertson on it?
I never heard it.
Another Perfect Day?
No, he filled in for who? For...
No, there's a Motorhead album called Another Perfect Day. Brian Robertson is the guitar player on that album.
Who is the other guy?
Instead of Fast Eddie?
Yeah, Fast
Eddie left the band. Brian Robertson came in. Go back in the Rock and Roll Geek app and look for Classic Albums Revisited, Motorhead, Another Perfect Day.
Okay.
That album is different than any other Motorhead album, and it is fucking great.
I will. And the reason...
It's great because Brian Robertson's on it.
He's a good guitar player, but... Because he hurt himself, that's why I got to see Gary Moore.
I think he didn't hurt himself. I think they kicked him out of the band or something.
Somebody said before the tour, he was helping a friend in a bar, and he hurt his arm. Right. He hurt his hand.
Maybe, but he never came back to the band.
That's true.
So that should tell you something.
They had Gary Moore followed by a guy, I don't know why they got him.
Midger? Oh, no, you're Snowy White.
I didn't like.
Snowy. That album was Snowy White, Renegades, one of my favorite Thin Lizzy albums.
I know, but I was disappointed.
I figured you'd be a Snowy White fan because he's one of those guitar heroes.
No. And then they had my favorite, the last album, for Thunder and Lightning.
Oh, John Sykes, yeah. Yeah, that's a good album. That album, the song Bad Habits, I like that song.
Yeah, I have so many albums and I have none now.
You got rid of all your vinyl?
Years and years ago. I have so much. I have enough MP3s that if I started them now, it would go for 10 years.
Uh-huh. You illegally download music?
Since the day I learned about Napster, before they got shut down, I used to start my computer. I used to download on Napster, like before I went to sleep.
Uh-huh.
One song. And when I woke up in the morning, it was still downloading.
To download one song, yeah, I was back in the days of dial-up.
Talking about when they only had what's called 56K.
Oh, yeah. I remember. I was there. Yeah,
but I have what's called discographies of almost every band.
Yeah, yeah, me too. So you get on, you do the Pirate Bay thing or what?
What's that?
You do Pirate Bay? Is that what you do?
Pirate Bay?
Yeah. How do you illegally download all your music?
That's what I use.
You use Pirate Bay.
And then and then they closed them down for a while, and I went to another place called Demon.
Uh-huh.
Demonor.
Uh-huh.
I got a website for music. I got a website for movies.
Oh, you do? Oh, you mean a website that you go to download stuff? What's your give a little tip for everybody. What's your go-to website for downloading porn?
I don't. I don't remember the name of it, but it's RARGB.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I know that site. Oh, yeah. RARBG.TO or something like that. I'll tell you right now. Hold on a second. Here's a little tech tip for all you perverts out there. Hold on. Hold on. RARGB. Hold on. RARBG.TO. I was right.
They have more than just that, but they are the biggest for that.
Yeah, they have TV shows and stuff too, but I've downloaded. I don't download porn, but I've heard that that's a good site. Let's just say that. Put it that way.
There's no better one.
There you go, friends. Richard Fusey approved.
I give it four pricks up.
Four boners. Four pricks up. Richard Fusey approved. RARBG.TO. All right. What's your porn style of choice? You know, Dave Slusher likes the BBW.
Big black cock.
No. Not BBC. BBW. Big beautiful women. It's fat chick porn.
Nah.
You don't like that?
Nah.
What's your go-to porn?
What do I like?
Yeah, gay.
I don't want everybody to call me a pervert. Why should I say?
Well, we're all perverts, man. What dude do you know that is not a pervert? If he's not a pervert, he's a fucking liar.
No, you know what I like? I like the barely 18.
Oh, barely legal?
Yeah.
Oh, man, you are a pervert.
Is he?
No, I'm fucking with you, man. All right. Well, that's okay, I guess. I'm not into the young, to the barely legal because my daughter, I just feel creeped out. But it's okay.
It's like my nephew, same thing with my nephew. Once he had his own kids, completely changed.
I like the older women who are a little dumpy. I like older amateur porn.
You're a MILF.
I guess MILF amateur MILFs, wife porn, housewife porn. Is that perverted? Probably.
No, I don't think so.
All right, well, good. Oh, you're into barely legal. That's fairly, most guys, that's probably what most guys watch. You're not into the stepbrother or stepmom or whatever, stepsister.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, too. Yeah.
Oh, you like that? That's probably the most popular.
Yeah, I liked it.
Babysitter? Yeah. You like babysitter?
Oh, yeah, of course. Oh. Yeah.
All right. So, having Parkinson's, you're still able to, unwind with Parkinson's.
Let me set it straight for any guys out there that might worry. You don't lose your libido at 65.
That's good to hear. That's good to hear.
So don't worry about it.
All right. Well, man, I think my friend Manitoba would agree with you. All right. Well, that's good. Anything else about, like, I guess we're going into the danger zone here talking porn.
Yes.
We went from, we were talking about downloading albums to somehow we got on the subject of porn. You let me go down this path, Richard Fucci.
I'm sorry.
You want to play another tune?
Sure.
We're 1 hour and 49 minutes into this. I'm having a good time. We'll go at least 15 more minutes. How about that?
That'll be perfect because I got to take my medicine.
What medicine do you have to take?
Medicine, anti-tremor medicine.
What is that medicine called for stop tremors?
Well, there's something in your brain called levodopa. And carbidopa, it's two things that your brain naturally makes. And when you have Parkinson's, it doesn't make enough of what. And what it does is it blocks the signals from the brain to a part of the body. In other words, I make my left hand right now is in a fist.
Because if you unfist it, you'll start shaking.
No, it's just part of the disease. The muscles contract.
Oh, it gets involuntarily into a fist?
Yes, I have no control. My left hand right now.
Only the left hand?
It's so far. My left leg, my arm, and my right foot. That's why I can't walk.
Oh, okay. You have somebody there 24 hours a day with you?
Yep.
Somebody's there right now?
Yep.
Is it a female?
It's a woman.
So you always have a woman, right?
From Jamaica.
Where's she? Is she in the other room?
She has her own room, yeah.
Oh, you have somebody who lives there with you?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I got somebody here 24/7.
So they do shifts, or is it all the same, always the same person?
One from Monday to Friday.
Uh-huh.
Then Friday she goes home, and another lady comes from Saturday and Sunday. But what I like about them, they don't bother me. If I don't need them and I don't text them, you know, from my room, they will not come in here and bother me.
They have to bathe you and stuff?
They have to aid me in bathing.
They have to do what?
They have to help me bathe.
Okay, they have to help you lift you up into the shower or bathtub?
No, I can do all that. I can go to the bathroom by myself. But I can't take a shower alone. It's not safe.
So they,
I can't.
What do? You can't, sit down and you let the shower go, and then you sit down and they scrub you, or you scrub yourself?
I do myself. I have a bench.
So they see you're naked?
Yeah, and they clean my dick and balls.
You ever get a boner with them in the room around
them?
No. You don't?
No, it goes and it hides.
Oh, really? They're not good looking?
Yeah.
They're not good looking?
No.
Oh, they're fat?
I had one that was good looking once. She had the most perfect breast, but.
Yeah, and?
Nothing happened.
You hit on her and she said, fuck this, and she didn't come back?
No, I just, when she first came, I said, uh-oh, what's going to happen the first time she...
Uh-huh, when she bathes your, washes your dick?
Yeah, but no. I said, why are you down there? Can you take care of me?
Did you say that to her, really?
No.
I wonder what would happen if you like offered him a 50 to do that.
They might.
You ever think about these women? They're
just not to make things on a bad note, but I had a male aide.
Oh, he jerked you off?
I had him part time. Came Monday through Friday for 4 hours.
Uh-huh.
He used to get cop pot for me and stuff.
Oh, he did? Okay.
About 3 months ago. He hasn't been my, what do you call it? He hasn't been an aide for me for a while. About 3.5 months ago, he had a fight with his girlfriend over something. Uh-huh. She came back and shot him.
She killed him?
Yep.
Holy shit.
And she ran to Miami and they caught her in Miami.
Wow. Man, that sucks.
Yep.
Was he, I was going to say, was he gay? But that's a stupid question because his girlfriend shot him. He wasn't gay. Well, I'm sorry to hear that. So these women who take care of you now, they're not good looking?
No.
Fat? What are they? Are they Asian?
No. I wish. That's what I like.
Old ladies? Old, super old senior citizen ladies?
No.
Fat?
I don't want her to hear me. I doubt she can, but she's from Jamaica.
Uh-huh. There's nothing wrong with that.
And she's a Jesus freak.
Huh. I wonder what would happen if you pulled out your schlong and said, help me out here, Jamaican woman.
she's very nice. She helps me fill my pipe for me.
Oh, well, she's a Jesus freak, but she's okay with pot.
She's okay with pot, because she's from
Jamaica. You smoke with her? You give her a hit?
No.
So with the Corova thing going on, did they wear masks or they have to be vaccinated?
I got my vaccine. I got the two shots.
So you don't make them wear masks in your house then?
No, they do. They wear masks only because they go out a lot. They're doing it to protect me.
So they don't wear. So Why? You got vaccinated. What do you care? They're not going to give it to you. You got vaccinated.
Yeah, I know that, but she's just very stubborn.
Yeah, see, people have been trained now to wear masks. We've all been trained like dogs.
If you came into my house and to visit me and you came in my room, she'll come over after you leave and say, okay, where did he go?
She'd wipe it off with bleach?
Yeah, yes, yes.
Oh, brother.
Every day. When the nurse comes to see me to take my vitals or somebody comes to visit me to bring me something, she wants it. Where do they go? And she's...
Well, she's Jamaican. She's probably good looking, right?
No.
No, she's not. If she's not good looking, she's Jamaican, I would assume she's fat then, right?
Uh-uh.
She's not fat. She's skinny. She got super long, haggardy looking fingernails or something. Do you ever walk in the bathroom after these after they shit? They have a different bathroom.
I have my own bathroom.
They have their own bathroom too.
I have a pretty big house.
How many bedrooms is your house? Two bedrooms?
Three.
Three bedrooms. What's in the third bedroom? Is that your media room?
That's where my mother died, in the other room.
Oh, so you leave that as a shrine to her?
Yeah, and when my mom died, we took everything out of that room, and my sister put in everything new, and she set it up so that when she comes to visit,
sister,
she had a room to sleep with her and her husband.
Okay. So did they cook dinner for you too, or cook all three meals for you?
Yes.
What do they make for you?
One of them brings me Haitian food.
Haitian, so she's a Haitian woman. One of them is Haitian.
Yeah.
What kind of food is Haitian food? I've never had Haitian food.
A lot of rice and beans and chicken dishes and stuff like that.
Like jerk chicken or blackened chicken type stuff. Okay. It's more like, it's kind of like
Alexa's just went off.
Alexa just went off?
In my house to tell me I have to take my medicine.
Oh, okay. So you want to wrap this up so you can take your medicine?
I want to do a closeout song or something.
Okay, let's do that. You want to pick it or can I pick it?
Whatever you want.
How about...
Doesn't have to be from my list.
No, I want to make it from yours. How about Sex Pistols? You got Sex Pistols on here. Sex Pistols, Cars, or Aerosmith? Which one would you
Bodies.
Like? Bodies, okay, that sounds good. All right, well, Richard Fusey? Or Richard Fucci? Or Richard Fusey? It's Fusey.
Yep.
I am very glad you came on. I like you 1,000 times more than I did like you after talking to you on the phone.
That's nice to know.
As a matter of fact, I think I consider you a friend. I hope you consider me a friend.
I do.
If you ever come out to San Francisco, I mean, that may not ever happen, but if you ever do, you got a place to crash. And you know what? I won't wipe your ass, but I'll get my wife to wipe your ass.
You take me fishing.
Well, in a kayak, I don't know if I can. I'll take you out on a boat. I will go out on a, we'll charter a boat. Yeah.
I tried about, I puke my guts out every time I do it. I finally have to give it up.
Well, you come out here, you got a place to crash. I'll make you dinner. I'll make you breakfast, lunch, and dinner. I will not wash your dick for you.
Okay, that's fair enough.
I'll tell my wife too. She might. I mean, I can't make her because, you know, but she might. All right, Richard. All right, this joke is going nowhere.
I was just looking.
Richard Fusey, thank you very much for doing this. I had a good time talking to you. I could talk to you for another 2 hours.
I have a lot of stories, but
you are an interesting dude. You got an open invitation anytime to come on the Rock and Roll Geek Show, friend. We don't even have to get donations for you to come on. Aren't you glad you came on?
Yes.
I feel like I know so much more about you now that I talked to you. I think everybody is going to say, wow, Richard Fusey is a good fucking dude.
I could have gone in a different direction and just talked music and nothing else.
We did music talk. We talked about everything.
I was trying to think what the last concert I went to, but it was such a long time ago.
Yeah, it's been a long time since I went to a show.
That's how long ago it was.
You think you'll ever get to go see a show again?
I doubt it.
Well,
that's why I own over 250 concert DVDs.
If I got rich and could hire somebody to come into your house and play acoustic guitar for you, or play an acoustic show, who would you like for me to get?
Acoustic?
Yeah, or just bring a guitar and you know, however loud they can be in your house. I mean, we don't want the cops called.
I don't even know. I want Michael Schenker to come.
All right. If I get rich, I'm going to
hire him for a private.
I will hire
time.
Michael Schenker to come to your house in Florida and play in your living room.
Sounds good.
All request. That might cost about $100,000, but if I get the money, if I get rich, I'll do it.
Hey, listen, I wanted to ask you something. I just got two books from my book club, my audio books. I see one by Mack Bell.
Cowboy Mack Bell, yeah. Have you listened to that one?
Is it a good book?
It's just fucking great, man. You didn't hear him come on? You didn't hear him on the show?
No, I don't think I did because I saw the book in audio.
Wait a minute. I've had Cowboy Mack Bell on the show 3 times, and you've never listened to either of those, any of those?
No. I have to check it out.
Listen to the first one. Listen to the. I had him. He was on like 2 hours. Listen to that first Cowboy Mack Bell interview, and you'll be hooked on the book. Get the audiobook. The audiobook is great. It's better than the book, and the book is great.
I'll check it out.
Yeah, get it. You will not. You will thank me. It's got Earthquake. It's got people doing. It's got guests on the. Big guest appearances. The bass player comes on. Charlie Farron from the second Joe Perry Project album comes on. Earthquake Morton does narration. It's a great book, and it's very funny, and it's some great stories. Cowboy Mack Bell is a very interesting guy.
All right, I'll look. I'm going to check it out.
Joe Perry Project fam, right?
When I get an audiobook, after I finish it, they allow me to take 3 books a year that I get and turn them in automatically for anything else I want.
Oh, okay.
Like an exchange.
So you're listening to They Just Seem a Little Weird book right now?
I'm halfway through that.
It's good, isn't it?
Yeah, I just gotten a couple of more. I don't remember what's. I have so many, Michael.
Were you a Stars fan?
A what?
Because they just seem a little weird. It's about Aerosmith, Cheap Trick, and Stars.
Oh, I have it. I have the book.
So I'm asking you, are you a
it's
star?
All the groups that you like. It's all the bands that you like.
Yeah, are you a fan of Stars, the band?
Yeah, I saw them in concert twice.
Oh, you did? Okay.
Yeah.
Huh. Richie Rano.
Rano, yeah. And Michael Smith, or is that somebody else?
Yeah, Michael Lee Smith, singer for Stars.
And Rex is his brother.
Rex Smith, yes. I saw Rex Smith open for Ted Nugent. Michael Lee Smith and Richie Rano and Joe Dube are now friends of mine.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, American Heartbreak did some shows with them. And the Butler's very first show we played, we opened for Stars and Mark Farner. It was the very first show we ever did out of town. Those guys have become good friends.
Mark Farner.
Oh, yeah.
My first guitar hero.
Oh, really? Well, backstage in the dressing room, there was a cooler, and it was taped shut, and it said, "Do not drink. This is for Mark Farner only." And you know what happened when Mark Farner was on stage, right?
No.
We drank his beer.
Oh, really? I know Mel and what's his name? And Don screwed him pretty good.
Oh, yeah. I don't know. Oh, yeah, probably. Yeah, they went out Grand Funk without Mark Farner. Yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
He only sang, played lead, and wrote everything.
Yeah, yeah. So why not? Why not fuck the guy over?
They own the name. How the hell did they end up with
that? That's what happens. All right. Anything else you would like to say, Richard Fusey?
Thank you, everybody, for getting me to do this podcast.
Yes, thank you, everybody, because I'm glad Richard Fusey came on. This was a real pleasure for me, and I'm not bullshitting you either, Richard.
I know. I'm going to hear at the end. Train wreck. No, I'm shit.
You will. It will be. I'll play that at the end. But no, seriously, I thank you for coming on. It was very entertaining. Hold on. Let's play Bodies, and then I'll come back and say goodbye, okay?
Okay.
All right, here's Sex Pistols Bodies. Richard?
Yeah, stay frosty, my friend.
Stay frosty. Richard, take care of yourself. You glad you did this?
Yes.
I am glad you did it. Go take your medicine and have a good...
And then I'm going to take some smoke and I'll be good.
Okay. Smoke a joint and take that medicine. Richard Fusey, I'll talk to you soon, friend.
Thank you.
All right.
Good night.
Good night. There you go, friends. The great Richard Fusey. I enjoyed that. Good guy. Everything that everybody's, well, no, I don't think anybody said anything bad, but I like Richard Fusey. He's welcomed on my show anytime. Thank you, Richard Fusey, for doing this. And thank you, friends, for listening. Like Richard Fusey said, this is a bonus episode. So, but if you got any value out of this, rockandrollgeek.com, hit the donate button, friends. Value for value. Find me on the Facebook, R&R Geek. Find me on the Twitter, R&R Geek. Find me on the Instagram, Rock and Roll Geek. Don't ask. Find the show, Rock and Roll Geek, rockandrollgeek.com. Find me. Send me an email, rockandrollgeek@gmail.com. Let Richard Fusey know that you enjoyed him on the show, or let him know you didn't enjoy him, whichever one. I enjoyed him. That's all that matters. But thank you, friends, for listening. And thank you again the following people are, Michael Cranston, Joe Pawlak, Rodney Cross, Tim Shaw, Ralph Miller, Jason Wendleton, and Kurt Crawford, and anybody else who wants to contribute to the Richard Fusey show fund, it's very much appreciated, friends. You guys all saved the show this month, and I appreciate all of you. I consider you all friends. You're all close friends to me, and anytime any one of you people come to Jackson, or I'm not in Jacksonville, San Francisco, look me up, friends. You got a place to crash, okay? I will talk to you soon. Keep sticking it to the man, friends.
It's a Rock and Roll Geek train wreck.